The Pilgrim of 1928 was aware that land discovered beyond the South Pole point confirmed only one aspect of physical continuity. He knew that there would have to be photographic confirmation of his disclosure concerning terrestrial skylight and the deceptively globular and isolated appearance of outer sky areas. Only through such proof could he hope to establish the illusory nature of astronomical conclusions dealing with celestial areas. Hence his pilgrimage was directed toward procuring the required photographic proof through a stratosphere ascent, which would permit photographing an area of the Earth's luminous outer sky surface from stratosphere darkness. Though there had never been a record of terrestrial skylight, he knew the condition would be confirmed if it was possible for him to ascend into the stratosphere. The lens deceptions contingent upon telescopic observation and photography of luminous celestial areas was most clear to him, but duty to his cause seemed to demand that he spare no effort to show the comparisons at terrestrial level so that others might comprehend the illusions. Therefore, from 1929 until 1935 he sought means whereby he might ascend into the stratosphere. And during that period he recorded the conditions of lights and their movements which produced illusion in the workaday world at terrestrial level. He relentlessly pursued the mathematical contradictions of theory, which had over a period of 400 years made an incomprehensible patchwork of the universe about us. Though the abstract mathematical values were understandingly applicable in the 15th century, when only the abstract could apply in an interpretation of cosmic values, they loomed as poor makeshift in the light of modern research and discovery. For nights without number he patiently observed the brilliant but deceptive beacons of the celestial sky from vantage points on the desert sand and from lofty mountain ledges. In such application he was able to compare the movement of lights observed at every angle on terrestrial level with the seeming movement of lights at celestial level. And he discerned the synonymity of illusions developed from light manifestations at both levels. The simplest observations held a meaning most profound. And he who dutifully sought the meaning watched and recorded the apparent movement, or twinkling, of stationary streetlights in Oakland, California. That observation was made from the deck of a ferry plying the 7 miles of water from San Francisco to Oakland. Such simple observation proved that the streetlight's seeming motion was attributable to the motion of water between his sensitive optic lenses and the lights of Oakland. And it was thereby discerned that known and unknown conditions existing between a telescope lens and luminous gaseous sky areas of the celestial produce the same illusion of motion. He never tired of experimenting with the play of electricity in the filament of light bulbs of every size and variety. He observed the light's movement from every angle and under every condition. And such enterprise afforded proof of the influence all light exerts on the optic lens, and on every other lens, for all of which the human lenses provided the pattern. Observation of the light distortions resulting from magnification of light at various distances provided foundation for understanding of the observational error leading to the absurd astronomical conclusion of planetary rings. His perception reduced the so-called celestial rings to unreal whirling companions of correspondingly unreal astro-mathematico globular entities assumed to constitute the universe. His persistent application and study of the most humble but realistic manifestations at terrestrial level brought discernment of the complete lack of meaning in seeming manifestations at celestial level. The astronomically prescribed celestial features of puffs of smoke in a barrel, double stars, galaxies, etc., were reduced to simpler but realistic values of cosmic expression adequately described in following pages. The uninvolved play of searchlights on a darkened sky, or other dark area, proved the inability of the lens to record any area faithfully. as the searchlight disclosed that it was compelled to reproduce its circular lens outline on formations of every nature other than globular. It was made manifest that areas not globular in reality were made deceptively globular by the lens. The distorting influence of mist and fog on luminous areas and objects of the land and the waters contributed to his elaborate ritual of the years. And the study of such influence at work brought confirmation of physical continuity before the first photograph of terrestrial sky-like distortion existed. And that single feature materially contributed to the premise that the universe is astronomically assumed to be can never exist. It was found that halos and rings, and spheroidal intruders of reality's magnificent scene, are found wherever and whenever one seeks them under conditions making for their elusive development. In consideration of the ease with which they are promiscuously manufactured, there is little wonder that they are observed in telescopic observations of the celestial. He diligently watched and studied the movements of airplane lights reflected against the darkened sky and against the background of other lights in nearby hills and distant mountains. And he was permitted to discern the gross deception the moving airplane lights would impose on the immature mind of some native from an undeveloped region of our civilization. Such a native, lacking knowledge of the altitudinal relation of hills, mountains, and the moving airplane lights and their relation to other lights in hills and mountains and of the celestial sky, would be unmistakably awed by the indefinable spectacle. It was found reasonable to conclude the native's ignorance of the placement and purpose of the various lights, in relation to those of the unknown airplane in motion, would permit no other determination than that the moving airplane lights represented some fearful unknown entity or condition of the so-called heavens above. Though familiarity with moving airplane lights at night enables the more enlightened to comprehend realistic value of the lights and their movement, they are, nevertheless, as readily confused by corresponding light movement and light distortions developed at their immediate terrestrial level. Hence it may be understood that the measure of deception for the average person is multiplied by the seeming movement of known and unknown lights at celestial level. Early experimentation established that illusion can readily be fostered in the most astute minds through land surface observation of the light over which, under conditions favorable to its development, enshrouds an airplane's lights as well as the plane, and produces the illusion of a luminous disk moving through the night sky. Inasmuch as a saucer is a disk, the illusion of flying saucers is imposed. It was also proved that haze, fog, clouds, and angles of observation contribute to the foregoing and numerous other illusions. It was further established that even on a very clear night the lights of an airplane in motion present nothing but a flying saucer if they are observed through a translucent window glass. The same illusory developments were found to apply to a bright arc light at the negligible distance of 50 feet from the observing lens as they apply to the moon at its estimated distance of about 335,000 miles. And, as distance lens enchantment, the illusion determinable as such at 50 feet is without question accepted as celestial reality when advanced by an astronomical conclusion which holds no possible hope of determination. Though the disguise and projected illusions of lights in luminous areas can single quote be ably penetrated at a distance of 50 feet on terrestrial level, they do, nevertheless, impose temporary deception until investigative determination of their realistic value is had. Hence, consider the enlargement of deception of values. Observation of the unpretentious flame of an ordinary match eloquently affirmed principles of lens function and deceptions resulting therefrom. Experimentation established that the perpendicular flame of lighted match in the darkness is automatically distorted by the camera lens, which, in night photograph, causes the flame to be reduced to a horizontal line. The situation developed in photograph from an airplane at an altitude of only 2 miles. It was thereby perceived that reducing the perpendicular flame to a flameless horizontal line constitutes primary expression of Olin's convergence. An increase of photographing altitude developed the secondary expression in lens function, producing the curve, as previously related. The camera lens curved that same horizontal line up at both ends in the beginning of an arcade. On complete lens convergence, achieved at greater photographing altitude, the match presented the photographic appearance of a luminous disc. The qualification should be made for readers who are unfamiliar with the fact that light is always photographed as white. Hence, though it was known that the white disc represented a luminous disc, the photograph area in a black and white photograph was white. This simple match experiment was not considered too simple or unimportant for the United States Army Corps' application of many hours. Therefore, consider what the lens is capable of doing to a straight line and how it can make globular and isolated luminous sky areas that are not globular or isolated. Then it may be possible to reconcile the illusions developing from observation of the celestial with that 2,000-year-old dictum, with eyes ye see not, yet believe what ye see not. That parable, too, merits repetition on every page of this book. Its meaning may be generally understood after another 2,000 years. It was found on another occasion that the match flame would, through optic lens function, develop an aura of greenish-red light when held in one's hand and viewed through mildly watering eyes. In other words, they would be formed, by the optic lens detecting the flame through a moisture film, a luminous and colorful circle which seemed to envelop the flame. That illusion in observing a known light not more than 6 or 8 inches from the detecting optic lens, and at a time when the least additional moisture between the lens and its object exerted such influence on the optic lens which distorted the object, holds very definite relation to telescopic lens detection of luminous celestial sky areas. Telescopic detection of luminous celestial areas must be had at tremendous distances and through numerous distorting and obscuring media. In some celestial sky-like areas, those media become at times much more powerful agents of the illusory than the eye moisture between an optic lens and a known luminous area close at hand. Though there need not prevail at celestial level a corresponding volume of moisture influencing illusory lens creations seen in the lighted match aura, there is unmistakable radiation from the gaseous content of all observed luminous celestial areas. The influence of such radiation between the detecting telescopic lens and a luminous celestial area, in conjunction with other conditions of the stratosphere, can be expected to develop corresponding match flame illusion of one and even more luminous circles. Such circles, or so-called satellites, can then deceptively appear to be circling around the observed luminous celestial area. At this point it should be explained that it is not only the distorting influence of media through which light is observed, and the function of light itself at the point of observation, which contribute to production of the illusory. There exists beyond such factors the influence which the observed light exerts on the detecting lens. There is expressed the value of, the more you look, the less you see. Too much looking distorts color. Too intent observation of light in luminous areas produces the distortion of light, shadows, or shading. Continued observation of too intense light causes the luminous area to become black. Let there be light. Yet the world of illusion is cluttered with light emanations. The sun becomes a positive bevy of multicolored globes when observed at the angle proper for their development. And in the multiple globes there are multiple smaller globular patterns. The universe of illusion has no end of globes and spheres and whirling globular bodies, though none exist in fact. the terrestrial parallel of heat radiation's power to distort luminous areas and objects was found in observation of a series of wall lights that were clear glass electric light bulbs. They extended at intervals of 10 feet along the interior wall of a room 100 feet in length. The room was heated from open ventilation on the opposite wall 10 feet away. From a position on the ventilator side of the room, observation was made of the electric lights at the further end of the room, 50 to 100 feet away. Hence the heat waves from the open ventilators were between the observing sensitive optic nerves and the electric lights. The motion of the heat waves, though not detected by the optic lens, produced the optical illusion that every light was flickering, or twinkling. A shift of position to the opposite side of the room, where the lights were seen without heat wave interference, at once permitted observation of the realistic unflickering lights, thereby proving the illusion. It is significant to note that this illusory condition was found to develop when the heat waves lacked sufficient force and volume to be seen by the optic lens. The radiation exerted its illusory action, though it was not seen as a barrier to a distorter of light observation. Earlier, a counterpart of heat waves influence was shown in the influence of water motion on the sensitive optic nerves as the optic lens detected streetlights in Oakland. Under such conditions of observation, the larger and more luminous streetlights were subjected to corresponding influence, and they afforded the same illusory performance. However, it is pertinent to record that the streetlight's movement was more pronounced at a distance of 5 to 7 miles than the illusory movement of electric lights at distances of from 50 to 100 feet. There is a lesson here of greater illusory movement with an increase of distance from observed luminous area. It is considerable to do with the Galilean premise of illusion, rounded bodies circling or ellipsing in space. Consideration of astronomical distances should bring understanding of physical continuity, and it should assist one to know that movement may be had from the terrestrial poles into the universe about us. As this is written, a tiny voice seems to bring in astronomers' expostulation that no such deceptions can be imposed upon the magnificent lenses of astronomy's workshop. And it contends that the greater power of telescope lenses penetrates the conditions that create the illusory. Therefore, it should be said that no amount of light magnification can produce greater clarity. The light and the lens seem to resent magnifying. Increased magnification of light in luminous areas develops a greater volume of light distortion. It becomes evident that the brilliant writer of yesteryear, Tiffany Thayer, was cognizant of such a feature when he referred to the 200-inch telescope lens then being perfected as the White Elephant of Mount Palomar. That lens is competent to magnify all the illusions of the centuries. Lens magnification of light and luminous areas, and the light distortion that ensues, is that which produces canyons on the moon and a grotesque array of astronomical entities that never did and never could exist on land or sea or in the universe about us. Light magnification is the imponderable which produces the light shadings in luminous celestial areas. Such light shadings within luminous sky areas are at times heralded as clouds in the stratosphere over the celestial skylight area. At other times, they are claimed to be vegetation on the celestial land under the skylight. At this point, it is well to repeat that telescope lenses cannot penetrate celestial skylight. It is true that clouds and vegetation are helpful to human beings. Without the clouds, vegetation might not exist. Hence, one may take one's choice as to what light shadings represent, other than light shadings. Though clouds and vegetation exist under the light which extends throughout the universe whole, such conditions cannot be detected through the luminous sky envelope. All that telescope lenses detect is an aspect of the luminous sky. These and innumerable corresponding truths of experimentation and brain observation have been developed through unremitting effort to refute or to verify the disturbing perceptional portrait of the realistic universe. For that portrait was presented to that early pilgrim as a burdensome and heartbreaking gift from the Force, which ordains out individual destinies. The gift could not be rejected, because the Force persisted in its endowment. But is it to be wondered that he who was so endowed made periodic attempts to abandon the gift? The hours he consumed in tedious combing through the centuries accumulation of astro-mathematical data embodying glaring contradictions that resulted from organized endeavor to sustain the postulate of terrestrial isolation constituted a period which could have thrice told the fables of A Thousand and One Nights fame. And time would have been left to erect all the unreal mathematical universes that history records. To accomplish a project of such magnitude that it opened the centuries ice block paths to the universe about us, that early pilgrim's elaborate laboratory was generally the uncluttered platform of the desert sands. And his customary astronomical observatory was an unsheltered mountain ledge. But his equipment was superior to the most powerful telescopes of Mount Wilson and Mount Palomar. At the latter, the 200-inch lens was then being ground and primed to see all and know all. Absurdum. Absurdum. It is the brain that truly sees. And telescope lenses do not have brains. His endowment fund was a flawless extrasensory perception, which had detected more of the realistic universe in 5 minutes than all the telescope lenses of the ages could detect. And his loyal organization was faith, his faith against a world of skepticism. In 1932 he met the Belgian stratosphere explorer, Professor Auguste Piccard, at the professor's quarters in the Hotel St. Moritz in New York City. It was there that he viewed the first photographs of the terrestrial outer sky that he had described before any lens had detected it. Picard's photograph showed a minute area of the Earth's sky as it is to be seen and photographed from within the sky. The photographs had been taken at Picard's greatest altitude, and that was only on the threshold of the stratosphere. Picard had not achieved sufficient altitude for a photograph against the stratosphere background of total darkness. Hence the photographic plates showed only the lower sky area through which Picard had entered. That sky area appeared as an illuminated upturned disk. The corners of the upturned disk were developing a copper tinge representing primary illumination of the immediate sky R. It was the color seen on cloud formation as the sun disappears far beyond the western horizon. Asterisk that illuminative coloring of the upturned or partial disk obscured the outline of the terrain where Picard's ascent originated. Nothing of the Earth's surface was to be detected by Picard or by the camera lens in the base of the stratosphere gondola. All that could be seen was the partly luminous partial disk development of the sky area being penetrated. Though Picard had not achieved sufficient altitude to permit the lens formation of a complete disk with total luminosity, his photographs confirmed lens function and the resulting deceptions as disclosed since 1926. If he could have increased his altitude, the partial, or upturned, disk would have been completed by the lens into a full disk. Both edges of the upturned disk, as shown at the beginning of stratosphere darkness, would have been continually drawn up by the lens until they met. Then the upturned disk would be detected from stratosphere darkness, and from all other areas of the universe, as a downturned curved area. When that condition exists, there is presented a complete disk surface, which is known as a disk. We do not speak of down-curved areas. When they present such formation, they are known as disc-like. The lens completes the circle because the lens is circular. With completion of the circle, the disk area is detected. The lens has done its job. Then the mind adds the finishing touch, which causes the illusory circular outline of the sky area to have body property. The fullness of body must exist for the adult mind, though there be no such fullness of body in reality. The appearance of that particular sky area being photographed in 1931 impelled Picard to announce, the Earth appeared as an illuminated upturned disk. However, it is self-evident that Picard meant that the photographed sky area appeared as an illuminated upturned disk. The word illumination has application in this instance because there was illumination. But there was no luminosity. There was not sufficient darkness of stratosphere background for luminosity to develop. Though the sky area being photographed from within the sky depth was not luminous, the primary illumination was sufficient to obscure the land surface. Only increased altitude, with additional stratosphere darkness, would develop luminosity. Picard acknowledged in the early descriptive account that he could see nothing of the land surface, a copper-colored cloud enveloped the Earth. There is no doubt that Picard meant well. But he, or the journalist quoting him, used an exceedingly misleading choice of words as herein related. 1. The Earth did not appear as anything, because no area of the Earth could be seen or photographed. 2. It was only an infinitesimal area of the Earth's entire sky that provided the appearance of an illuminated upturned disk. 3. The copper-colored cloud was part of the gaseous sky density, which was developing luminosity. Observe Figure 4 in the next chapter. Released to the nation's science editors in 1930, it shows how every area of the Earth's luminous outer sky would appear from sufficient distance in stratosphere darkness and from all celestial land areas. If the luminous disk-like areas were to be drawn into complete circles, the lower half of each would describe the upturned disk. In viewing any luminous sky area like those shown from the depth of stratosphere darkness and from celestial land areas, the half-circle curves are presented as disks. There should be no confusion on that point. The feature could have been established in ancient Babylon if they had possessed V2 rockets. Unfortunately, when the luminous disk-like areas are detected at terrestrial or celestial level, the human mind automatically provides body property which does not exist. In such manner does the realistic universe become infested with isolated globes that do not exist. The Earth area of the universe whole could not escape the isolated globe infection. Astronomical dogma decreed that the luminous celestial areas detected were isolated globular or spherical bodies adrift in space infinite. And such being the case, the Earth had to be the same. Who could prove it otherwise in 1543, when the theory of astro bubbles was imposed? While we are at it, it might be well to turn to Figure 5 entitled, The U.S. Navy's V2 Rocket Camera Photographs Dispel the Illusion. The title is most fitting. The photograph shows a luminous outer surface area of the Earth's sky from an altitude of 65 miles. Altitude means distance from the Earth's surface. Hence the photograph was taken approximately 55 miles beyond the outer sky area. It might have been a little more than 55 miles, because the distance from land surface to sky varies at times, and at different places the sky is only 7 miles away, at other points it may be 10 miles. Figure 5 is a reproduction of the original V2 rocket camera photograph of a small area of the Earth's entire sky. The photograph was not taken on the perpendicular, as was the case in Picard's photograph of 1931. Hence it shows only at an angle the complete disk area, which Picard's perpendicular photography would have shown if he had ascended to the V2 rocket height. The rocket camera would have shown a round disk, rather than a foreshortened oval, if it had been in the rocket's tail so that it could photograph on the perpendicular during the rocket's ascent. As the rocket descended, it was drifting at an angle. Hence all photographs of the outer sky had to be at an angle. Had the rocket avoided drifting and descended in the perpendicular course, it would have shown the full disk area indicated in figures 3 and 4. That original photograph of an area of the Earth's luminous outer sky surface, seemingly globular and isolated, is the most important photograph in the history of the world. It tells more of the realistic universe about us than all the astronomical volumes compiled throughout the centuries. It needs only the proper interpretation. And if terrestrial man is not competent to interpret its meaning at this time, he should be denied acquisition of the universe about us. The white area of the photograph is the luminosity, which covers all sky areas. The dark areas depict light shadings developing from the gaseous movement which produces the light. Other factors may have influenced the shading as shown. If it had been a very powerful automatic lens photographing from the distance, magnification of the light surface would have occurred. Then the clear luminosity could be considered to exist only in the white patches. But that conclusion would be faulty. The light covers the entire area. From greater distance it would become manifest. There was reference earlier to such light shading being cloud formation. That term is acceptable if it means gas cloud formation. Otherwise it becomes ridiculous. If the shading or the white patches were in fact atmospheric clouds as observed from land surface, the surface of the Earth could also be detected. Nowhere does it appear, and it could be made to appear only through the application of an appropriate photographic medium capable of penetrating light. There is such a light penetrating medium developed by modern research, but its application can always be detected because the object or area photographed through light becomes distorted. As illustration, green vegetation is reproduced white, and the normal contour of objects becomes out of proportion. Though the medium referred to, infrared and extrasensitive film, has application to photography within distance limits, there is no record of its application to telescopy. If there existed, or if there is ever developed, a medium whereby telescopic lenses can penetrate the luminous celestial sky light, even astronomers will then be permitted to discern the factual universe about us. Then will they observe the land underlying the luminous outer surface of celestial sky areas, where astronomical conclusion has denied the existence of land. Then will they detect the abundant water and vegetation denied by astronomical conclusions of the centuries. And that vegetation will give the light to the astronomical assumption that celestial areas lack the oxygen content conducive to life. No astronomer, or his most powerful telescope lenses, has ever detected more than the luminous outer sky surface of any area of the universe about us. No telescopic camera ever photographed other than the same sky surface area, which is made deceptively disk-like and isolated by the lens function described here. Therefore, strange as it may seem, photographs of luminous celestial areas with fullness, or body, are products of illusion. The tragedy of their display is expressed by the misconception they foster. The lens-formed disk area of celestial sky is the only thing photographed, but the disk area must develop the delusion that a full and isolated body exists. in view of figure 4 showing what every terrestrial sky area would appear to be from the dark stratosphere and from other land areas of the universe. Professor Picard's photographic development of a partial disk with incomplete luminosity was not generally considered as evidence of the illusions described. Effort was therefore intensified to have photographs of the Earth's luminous outer sky made from greater altitude, which would show a complete disk with luminosity. The requisite altitude was considered 14 miles, 4 miles beyond Picard's altitude. With that objective, a journey was made to the U.S. Army Air Corps base at Wright Field at Dayton, Ohio. There, Major Hoffman and Captain Albert W. Stevens were making elaborate preparations for a stratosphere ascent, and it was believed that they could be induced to achieve a 14-mile altitude, where photographic confirmation of lens deceptions would be had. Captain Stevens, then considered the leading aerial photographer, had taken numerous photographs of the business section of Dayton, Ohio, at an altitude of 5 miles. Photographs from that altitude, doubtless with a very powerful camera lens, showed the known concrete structures of the business district being merged together by lens function. Such merging confirmed that photographs at greater altitude would cause the concrete structures deceptively to appear as rounded or globular. Although the converging function of our lenses had long been established, the extraordinary photographs reasserted known principles and contributed additional knowledge that lens function can create innumerable illusions at terrestrial level. And the illusions would develop from observation of objects and conditions with which we are most familiar. Hence it was not difficult to determine that there would be multiplication of the quantity and quality of lens-developed illusions in telescopic and photographic observations of remote luminous celestial areas, which are entirely unknown. Aerial photography has likewise established the gross deceptions resulting from altitudinal photographs of familiar terrestrial terrain where rivers, seemingly drawn to the surface of the land and deprived of natural depth and width, lost their identifying characteristics as rivers and were made deceptively to appear as streaks on the land surface. Through the courtesy of Major Hoffman and Captain Stevens, the Pilgrim of 1934 inspected the stratosphere ascent equipment at Wright Field and prescribed the altitude required for photographic confirmation of his earlier claim. The minimum altitude considered necessary was 14 miles, 10 miles from land surface to sky, and 4 miles into the stratosphere darkness beyond the sky. Captain Stevens gave assurance he would make every effort to achieve the required altitude. His initial attempt failed when the balloon burst shortly after the ascent was underway. Soon thereafter, November 1935, the ascent attained 14-mile altitude over the Black Hills of South Dakota. There is little question that at that altitude were made confirmative photographs showing complete luminosity and disk appearance of the sky area. Unfortunately, the photographs of that ascent were not released when requested. There was no further important development bearing upon physical continuity until October 1946. When the U.S. Navy's V-2 rocket achieved the unprecedented altitude of 65 miles. And its camera returned sensational photographs of an angle of a luminous, globular, and isolated sky area over White Sands, New Mexico. More recent rocket camera photographs from an altitude of 200 miles, May 1954, show a luminous terrestrial sky area estimated at 300,000 miles wide. It too is deceptively globular and isolated. In comparing such rocket camera photographs made possible by the U.S. Naval Research Bureau, it is important to observe that the globular and isolated appearance is produced at every photographing distance from the outer sky surface. There are no variations of contour, but there are variations of the light shadings and light distortions, which this work has properly stressed. With such conclusive photographic evidence of terrestrial skylight and the lens-developed deceptions of the sky's contour, there was reason to believe that some acknowledgement of the pilgrims' claims would be forthcoming from the established scientific order. It was reasoned that such vivid expression of lens deceptions would enable the most skeptical to perceive that identical deceptions were experienced in all telescopic observation of luminous celestial areas. As a result of the sensational rocket camera proof of celestial and terrestrial skylight synonymity and the apparent globularity and isolation of sky areas, it seemed that almost anyone would realize that astronomy has dealt only with celestial skylight and illusory features developed by telescopic lenses. The illusions now proved to develop from telescopic observations of the celestial attest that it was natural for Copernicus, Galileo, Newton, and others of their times to conclude that luminous celestial areas are globular and isolated bodies. The illustrious gentleman lacked modern mechanical devices for proving otherwise. Such being the case, it was necessary to prescribe mathematical space orbits for the seeming movement of such illusion-born entities comprising the universe. Thereafter, the concept of body and bodies became so fixed that it was impossible to return to the 1543 starting point for investigation of the premise. Though numerous men have questioned the premise, there could be no constructive investigation in the absence of more recent mechanical equipment. It is only through timely development of such equipment that proof has been had of the concept's development from the illusory. Apropos of that mechanical equipment, the early years of pilgrimage led to the cell-like laboratory of Dr. Robert Goddard, pioneer extraordinary in rocket construction. When in 1926 the pilgrim visited him at Clark University in Worcester, Massachusetts, he desired the rocket's perfection no less ardently than Dr. Goddard did. At that time, 28 years old, he did not dream that he would live to witness the rocket's spectacular performance, which has developed confirmation of his dream. Yet with all of modern mechanics, which surpassed the mechanics draped in the corridors of time, it took 20 years to utilize that rocket for proof of most sensational disclosures. And it is significant that such a powerful mechanical instrument for proof was first used to destroy. It might not have been utilized for profound scientific purpose, but for the fact that the military had become seriously interested in rocket development to meet the challenge of the worst war in history, World War II. In the proof now established for this work's principal features exists a parallel to the outlook of 1493, when a new world of land and water and life, which archaic theory had denied, was discovered. This land's existence had been denied as a result of an illusory condition accepted as real, the sky meeting the water. To overcome the flat earth concept developed from that illusion, it was of utmost importance for science to make plausible the existence of this new world. Hence, when there was advanced in 1543 a forceful ease to sustain the timely, though erroneous, concept of isolated celestial areas making up the so-called planetary system and simultaneously explaining the new world's existence, it was most acceptable. At the time, it was of primary importance to establish convincingly that the Earth's area, previously conceived to embrace only the old world, was in fact twice as large. And, to give assurance that one would not fall over the edge, it had to be shown how journeys could be accomplished from one side to the other side of what was considered a globe Earth. The feature stressed was that of the eastern and western water extensions then recently discovered to connect the old world with the new. The width had to be known, regardless of what the length might be. Progress was east to west rather than to north and south. If there existed northern and southern extensions, It was unimportant to the time. Promulgation of the globe Earth idea was simplified by the evident fact that the sun rises in the east and sets in the west. And it was further advanced through understanding that one could sail to the west and ultimately arrive at points in the east. It appeared reasonable to assume that the Earth's contour was that of a globe, or sphere. Since the assumed globe Earth had eastern and western limits in time and space, mathematical northern and southern limits which would make it conform to a sphere had to be provided. Thus mathematical formula decreed that Earth contour is comparable to that of assumed globular and isolated celestial areas. Though the assumed globularity and isolation of celestial areas has since been proved illusory, the frames of theory were obliged to accept such apparent conditions as fact. Hence the terrestrial, also assumed to be a globular and isolated area of the universe whole, like celestial areas was also assumed to be circling or ellipsing in space. The ancient theorists, lacking modern equipment for determination of cosmic reality, were convinced that the telescope lens was a faithful recorder of celestial conditions. Unfortunately, lens capriciousness was never considered in determination concerning arrangement and movement in the universe. However, from that faulty assumption of globularity and isolation there developed a basis for precise time measurement. Where previously the terrestrial day could be known with but two parts, the periods of light and darkness, the theory of terrestrial globularity and isolation made it possible to gauge the light and the dark periods through the application of hours. And the hours, naturally, corresponded to the assumed Earth sphere's assumed daily movement. It may be perceived that the same time measurement could have applied if, contraries, it had been assumed that the sun described a daily course around the Earth from east to west. Then it would have made little difference if the Earth were assumed to be globular, cylindrical, or tubular in contour. Sun movement could provide hours of the day as readily as Earth movement did. The assumed circling movement of the assumed Earth sphere was made to conform to the time gauge, and the time gauge conformed to the assumed movement of the assumed Earth sphere. Hence the mathematized approximate 24,000-mile circumference of an assumed globe Earth invited mathematical determination that 1/24 of the Earth's assumed daily turn in space would constitute 1 hour. Therefore, since one assumed complete rotation of the assumed globe Earth of 24,000-mile circumference would constitute an Earth day of 24 hours, there had to be 24 different starting points for time. Every 1,000 miles of the 24,000-mile circumference would factually experience a different 12 o'clock noon and a different 12 o'clock midnight. Such mathematizing was by no means complicated. It then followed that the diameter of the man-made globe Earth would have to conform to global dimensions. Accordingly, there had to be formulated assumed northern and southern diminishing points for the assumed globe Earth assumed to be isolated in space infinite. Reality could not be consulted, and it could in no way control designation of the assumed northern and southern ends sustaining the globular concept and the isolated Earth globe. Man, having established the Earth's contour and limits to meet the need of that time, had very little interest in the physical aspects of the northern and southern extremities, which his mathematics had ordered. His interest was centered in travel east to west from the Old World for conquest of the Western New World. After the assumed globe Earth's assumed ends were mathematically fixed in time and space, there had to be provided an independent orbit, or space path, for its assumed daily and yearly movement in relation to other assumed cosmic globes scattered throughout timeless infinity. They, too, had to be made to conform to the mathematical order perfecting man's illusory universe. Hence it may be perceived that man, rather than creative force or deity, was responsible for the 15th century pattern of the Earth and the universe about the Earth. Nevertheless, the pattern woven from illusion served a purpose and filled a need of that time. It can be readily realized that the interest of 400 years ago could not, and need not, be in any constructive manner directed toward the assumed ends of the assumed Earth globe. Lack of factual knowledge of the Earth's northern and southern extent explains why the most famous of American explorers as recently as February 1947 was impelled to describe the endless land extending beyond the assumed northern end of the Earth as the center of the great unknown. Though the universe structure imposed by the Copernican theory was developed from illusion, the misinterpretation of values bestowed certain benefits upon men of that era. It afforded adequate general understanding of this new world reality, and it provided a necessary and most helpful gauge of time, even though, in so doing, it prescribed a series of fanciful movements for assumed cosmic globe bodies, which, in common with the assumed Earth globe body, seemingly constitute the universe whole. Unfortunately, in providing such benefits, there also developed the very questionable benefit of belief that men would fall off the Earth ends north and south instead of the Earth's edges east and west. Theory may persistently oppose theory, but only fact can displace theory. The facts of our time disclose the fallacy of assumptive Earth ends north and south. Such facts of modern discovery provide abundant evidence that land and water extends indefinitely beyond both assumptive ends prescribed by theory of 1543. 20 years of deepening research into stratosphere darkness confirms the 1926 disclosure that every area of the Earth's outer sky surface, regardless of its size, presents a photographic replica of all that which has been observed of the universe about us. This feature alone provides conclusive evidence that things are not what they seem throughout the created universe. It proves that telescopically detected celestial light is the same sky light that has been proved to cover the Earth. Hence it is established that underlying all celestial lights is the same atmospheric density as that of the Earth, which makes the sky possible. It is shown that the gaseous sky content making our outer sky surface luminous against dark stratosphere background is the same gaseous substance making celestial luminosity. The sky and its light prevail even when no telescopic lens detects them. There are certain areas of our terrestrial sky light that cannot be detected in telescopic observation from land areas of the celestial. But that lack of detection in the way confirms the absence of terrestrial sky and its light. Therefore, in the modern facts of discovery confirming the presence of similar celestial skylight and atmospheric density as that which is known to prevail at terrestrial level, there is sufficient evidence that similar terrestrial vegetation and life exists throughout the universe whole.
Apprehending the lens in the act of deception in stratosphere photography. Stratosphere photographs prove how the lens develops curves which are seen as discs. They are purely illusory, and they impose a globe body delusion. This triple illustration expresses the historical sequence of events confirming the camera lens development of the deceptive curve. They confirm the physical continuity of the universe. On the left is depicted the beginning of curve development by the camera lens utilized in Augusta Picard's stratosphere ascent of May 1931, that achieved an altitude of 10 miles. Where Picard had barely penetrated through our familiar blue sky, there is shown the beginning of lens-produced curvature of that particular sky area. That appeared as an illuminated upturned disc. The center disk-like development shows the deceptive appearance of the sky area penetrated by Albert W. Stevens of the U.S. Army Air Corps, at the greater altitude of 14 miles over the Black Hills of South Dakota in 1935. The greater altitude permitted development of full curvature, which is detected as a disk. It represents completion of lens function, which develops the partial upturned disk into a full disk. The larger and more luminous disk at the right represents a luminous terrestrial sky area photographed by the U.S. Naval Research Bureau's rocket camera at the greater altitude of 65 miles, or about 55 miles from the sky's outer surface, which varies from 7 to 10 miles from the Earth's surface. These photographs, and others that followed at altitudes up to 200 miles, conclusively confirm the disclosures of 1927, that the Martians and other inhabitants of the universe are obliged to consider that luminous disk-like area over a white sands as a planet or a star. The photographs establish that every Earth sky area observed from beyond the Earth must deceptively appear as an isolated globe body comparable to the many luminous celestial areas of astronomy's fallacious star chart, which is in reality a celestial sky chart. Camera lenses of the stratosphere ascents and rocket flights were unable to penetrate through the impenetrable luminosity of our immediate sky at the negligible distances involved. Therefore, they could not detect the realistic land and life we know to be under the sky. Telescope lenses, including the recent 200-inch lens, are unable to penetrate through the luminosity of celestial areas to detect the equally realistic land, vegetation, and other life existent under every area of celestial life and all other celestial areas where no light is detected.